Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, and welcome to the museum.
That's good.
No, I don't know. No, you can't.
Oh, you can't.
We'll try this again. Good morning. Welcome to the museum. We've got Rod Lovell with us today, and we know Rod well. He was a very generous donor to the museum. He gave us a whole bunch of Orion technical manuals, and most precious, he actually gave us his father's message screamer. That you know, the messages they threw out of World War I airplanes, pre-radio days.
Yeah.
But the rare thing about it is it's actually got the message still attached, so it's far too fragile for us to display. But it's a wonderful artifact to have.
Pleasure.
But anyway, Rod's here to talk about his book. I hope most of you have read it. I certainly have. It's an absolutely fascinating story. And if Rod puts the passion into this talk that he put into his book, I think we're in for an entertaining time. So welcome, Rod.
Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you. And I'd like to thank Mike and also the museum for allowing me to do this morning. It's very much appreciated. Thank people who have come here, there are people here I know that have bought my book and read it, so they can ask questions later on if they want to. Not a problem at all. And also, I openly welcome if there's any CASA or TSB people here. There might be one or two that want to know the truth and are not indoctrinated. So if they are here, I genuinely welcome them. So a little bit about myself. This is a story about 1994. The ditching of the DC-3, but we'll just go through a little bit of my history. I'm a local boy, born in Victor Harbour, raised on a farm in Middleton, and in 1968 went and joined the Air Force, and in fact caught up with Norm, I think it was in 1968, so there's a few of us here that go back quite a way. In the Air Force, the Mirage, obviously, I flew in the Air Force, and the Learjet was in civilian flight. But both of those aeroplanes I've flown. The Mirage, for those who remember, was a beautiful fighter in the 1960s and 70s. I've actually flown at twice the speed of sound, which equates to 2,500 kilometres per hour. That doesn't mean anything to a lot of people. It really doesn't. But it takes 2 minutes to travel from Victor to Adelaide. 1 minute to get to McLaren Vale, and the rest of them to another minute to Adelaide CBD. So that's really smoking. So Tom Cruise and I are a bit like that, you know. So I was instrumental in closing two of Australia's international airports. Around 1980, I closed Tullamarine. It's another story which I won't go into now. There was a racehorse loose at midnight, so that's another story in itself. And this story today is about 94 when I closed Sydney International Airport. Norm, again, we used to fly those sort of aeroplanes, Orions. Everybody remembers them from up here at Edinburgh, and they've just been phased out to be replaced by the P8 Poseidon. There's a lot of people in South Australia, particularly down home Victor Harbour way, that remember me, what would we say, doing coastal surveillance, I think is the best way to put it. We never did beat-ups in those days, it was coastal surveillance. Beautiful aeroplane, absolutely beautiful aeroplane. I'm putting these on qualifications just so that you know, because when I talk about my accident, the CAA treated me as if I was a 50-hour pilot just straight out of Parafield or Goulburn Airport or something. But these are pertinent and important. So first class ATPL in Australia, American and New Zealand. I've been trained and qualified as a captain by, obviously, the Royal Australian Air Force, P3B Orion aircraft, Qantas, Boeing 747. For the record, I did not fly a Qantas 747. I got all my qualifications in the simulator. As you know, the simulators are so arranged and qualified these days that you can actually get your qualification in a simulator. The old TAA, DC-9, IPEC, DC-3, DC-9 Argosies. the FAA in a DC-3, Flight Safety International in the States, Learjet Citation, Department of Civil Aviation. Now, why I mention this, it doesn't want to work on there. Department of Civil Aviation, because they crucified me later on in my story, they had previously checked me out probably a dozen times, including DC-3s and numerous aeroplanes. So I've been trained and qualified and checked by the CAA. In excess of 500 simulator hours. That is not me, that's some old codger out the back or something. But anyway, very interesting. I mentioned 500 simulator hours, as Norm and other pilots would know here. If you're in a simulator and not working on an emergency, you've probably missed it. Simulators are high traffic, high density, high stress, where you're given multiple emergencies, and so you've got to prioritise and work them all out. So I've got in excess of 500 simulator hours on various aeroplanes. That's the modern simulator these days, as you know. My dear old dad was taken in 74, I think it was, when I was on P3s at Edinburgh. I owned a Tiger Moth because my passion, flying for me wasn't just a job, it was a passion. And it just meant so much, and so I decided that in my spare time, I'd go flying as well. The Air Force wouldn't give me an Orion on the weekend, so I bought a Tiger Moth. Beautiful aeroplane. A Beech 18, very much like a small DC-3, and I owned that from about 83 to 98 or something like that. Beautiful aeroplane. That, I think, is photographed at Parafield here when we did the Bicentennial Round Australia Air Race. So today's story, I don't know why that doesn't work on the screen, but anyway. Today's main story is about my accident in 1994, 24th of April, and we were tasked to take the Scots College Band from Sydney to Norfolk Island for Anzac Day service the following day. We were going to go to Sydney, Lord Howe for a refuelling stop, and then on to Norfolk Island. Each of those segments is about 500 miles, which is just under about 800 kilometres. So the day in question. Before I go into the takeoff, we, in all aeroplanes, whether you call it self-discipline from the Tiger Moth through to DC-3s, DC-9s, 747s, no matter what, whether it's civil or military aviation, we always have a pre-takeoff brief on what we're going to do. Sometimes it doesn't happen in single engine aeroplanes, but I used to do it just so that I knew what I was going to do in case of an engine failure or something. So before takeoff, we do an engine failure, takeoff, safety brief, and our intention was, takeoff down here, if we have an engine failure, come around to the left and land on the east-west runway. That was the easiest thing, and that's what most people do. So at just after 9 o'clock, we're given clear takeoff. The yellow dotted line shows our track over the ground. The green is where we lift off into the air, and the red dot down there is where we suffered the engine failure. So everything on the takeoff was normal, all the engine indications, all the takeoff parameters, all seemed normal to me. We were safely airborne, and at 200 feet, which was just above the height of the Sydney Tower. Sydney Tower's about 180 feet high, I think. So at about 200 feet, at the red dot, we had a left engine failure. And that was no surprise. No surprise at all. We had briefed on it. We knew exactly what we were going to do. 2 minutes before we take off, we were going to shut the engine down, do a left turn, come back in and land on the east-west runway. So we did the shutdown checks in accordance with the operations manual. And what was a hell of a surprise then was the fact that the aeroplane didn't perform. It should have kept going up. It didn't. It felt like a drag chute had been coming out the back. Remember the Mirages and some of the jet fighters years ago had a drag chute. You've got some here and so. And it felt like a drag chute had just been popped out the back and was taking the performance, taking the airspeed, taking everything away from us. So I had to think quickly then, because I knew this wasn't going to come out nicely and go around and land on the east-west runway. So my options were land on the new runway. That wasn't a new runway at the time. It was land, but there was no runway, there was no concrete on it or anything like that. It was full of mounds of dirt, machinery, the whole box and dice. So that wasn't an option. That would have been catastrophic. I could have attempted to put it back down on the remaining runway. That's a possibility. With a DC-3, you don't know. The hydraulics are very, they're not sus. They're 50, 80 years old. And with a DC-3, you don't know whether you've got one gear up, one down. They're both coming up, they're both going down. And so that was a consideration. Why I didn't do that, that's just an interesting one, right? Where I say, oh, we'll be returning shortly. That was at the end of the runway, right? So if I'd put it down and it had been on the belly and I couldn't stop, we would have gone over the edge. Have a look at all these rocks, sharp rocks above the level of the runway. So they would have just sliced the fuel tanks open and we would have been fricasseed, as I say. So that wasn't an option. So going back to this, I'll just mention too, all this, I'm taking quite a bit of time, right? I had 46 seconds from the time the engine failed to in the water. That's all, and I just, in mentioning, Sully had 208 seconds, right? That's fairly important. So I had to think what to do very quickly. And naturally, being an old P3 pilot, what do? Normal day, we practice ditching hundreds of times. And by practicing, we didn't contact the water, obviously. The water's down there. We'd say 2,000 feet or 5,000 feet, we're going to come back and configure the aeroplane and approach it, and the simulated seawater level would be at 5,000 feet. That's very important, and I tell you why, because ditching an aeroplane is entirely different to crash landing an aeroplane. Entirely. You've got to set it up differently, you've got to approach differently, and as I say to people, unless you practice it, I don't even know whether I'd attempt it, because it is so different. But anyway, we'd have practiced it hundreds of times in an Orion, so to me it was the only, I'm given a nice slice of water there and an aeroplane, so I set it up and ditched the aeroplane. It wasn't a problem at all. In the back of my mind, again, I reiterate 46 seconds, in the back of my mind is protecting the passengers, saving the passengers, sacrifice the aeroplane. You probably may have flown with people who think, they always think about protecting the aeroplane. Stuff the aeroplane. Look after the people. They're fairly important, those people. So we ditched down there. In the back of my mind was this. Now, if anybody remembers it, 1980, a Super King Air at Sydney Airport took off on the east-west runway. He had an engine failure and tried to make it back to the runway. That is actually the threshold of runway 34, the opposite direction to which we were taking off. And as you can see there, impact point is just a few feet below the runway wreckage, and that was very sad. That's in the back of my mind the whole time. 13 people died, including a one-week-old baby. And that was such a powerful force in my mind as to how I was going to conduct the ditching. That's a 3D view of our track over the water. We ditched in that position. I intended ditching about 50 metres away from the new runway. The reason being, I thought, well, survivors, if there was survivors at that time, that they could climb up onto the runway. I thought, well, that's a fair cop. I knew this other one had rocks all around. I didn't know what the new one had. But what I didn't know was that the new runway, and they probably do it around the world now, I don't know, had an anti-wave protrusion on it. So the concrete barrier came up like this. So that's the water out there, and that's a runway here. About a metre out, about 10 foot above the water level, they went like that. And that's an anti-wave surge or whatever it is to stop the waves crashing over the runway. Fair enough, but I didn't know that. So all my thoughts about the passengers climbing aboard. In fact, the passengers eventually had to be rescued by firemen who put ladders over the side. This is a very interesting photo for lots of reasons. That's just obviously seconds after we ditched. I'm still in the cockpit. That person up the top, I won't call him a gentleman, that person up the top is a co-pilot, our co-pilot. Just behind us, just here, there were media people. And when we hit the water, I turned around and expected to see carnage. I expected to see arms and legs and blood everywhere. I really did. I was incredibly rewarded by seeing these kids stand up, putting their life jackets on. There was no panic. If you watch Air Crash Investigation, which I do, I think it's a very good show, but they show all these people, and there was none of that. Everybody standing up, incredibly disciplined, and that they're commended because of their actions on that day. But the media behind me, the cameraman, a guy by the name of Chris Pavlich, we only learnt this about 2 months ago by people who were actually on board the aeroplane. I won't go into it, but we didn't have a lot of contact with the college. We had zero contact with the college, the passengers, or anything, for lots of reasons, which I won't go into now. So Chris Pavlich gets up, races down the center of the aircraft. He's pushing kids and women aside so that he can be in the first boat to be in this boat here to turn around and take that photo. Right? You're a real hero, that guy. And he won an award for that. He won the Wakeley Award for photo of the year, news photo of the year or something. So he's a real hero. The other guy on board, the other media guy, was a guy called D.D. McNichol. Now there's two D.D. McNichols, I think. There's a senior and junior. I think this was a junior, but he was about 50 or 60. He wrote in the newspaper that when he was on board and we crashed, we went under the water, bounced off the bottom, and came up again like that. And that's all on the net. You can read it there now, you know. That water was 21 metres deep. So, and in the book, as people would know, I said to people, he's watched too many Hollywood movies. This is not reality. It's really not. The other thing about the photo, the person up there, the co-pilot, just after all this happened, he got out the overhead escape hatch. He walked along the top of the fuselage and he hopped on the other side of the tailplane, on the starboard tailplane, and went into a rescue boat. Never even got wet. But the interesting thing is, he's part of the crew. And what did he do? He deserted his passengers. I'm absolutely shocked. I don't know whether he was Greek or Italian or something. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say things like that, you know, Concordia and things like that. But he deserted the passengers. I find that unbelievable. And then after I was up the cockpit doing shutdown checks about make sure the fuel's off, electric's off, anything I can do to make sure the aeroplane is still safe. And then I went through the aeroplane, much the same as Sully, checking all the seats and compartments to make sure there was nobody left on board the aeroplane. The aeroplane, it's hard to say, I think it floated for possibly 10, 15 minutes. Time is a little bit hard to judge in a situation like that. You may have all read or heard that if you're facing death, time slows down and you review all your life and things like that. Well, that didn't happen for me. That 46 seconds went like that. It really did. So it's very interesting how different people perceive different things. I like that photo. As you can see, it's on my badge. To me, that's a grand old lady giving one final salute before she slipped below the waves. I think it's very nice. About 3 days later, they put the airbags around and try and lift the old girl off the bottom. That gentleman there is called Rip Somebody, and he lived up to his name. He put steel cables around the tail, around the wings, everything. So the damage that was done to the aeroplane, if you ever saw it, was done by that character. It wasn't done by my ditching. There was very little damage done in the ditching itself. Obviously, engine cowls come off. Okay, I shouldn't, we'll get that one in a sec. So, after the accident, they asked me, the CAA, the Civil Aviation Authority, asked me to attend counselling. Now, counselling in their definition is I've done something wrong and I have to attend counselling so that they can tell me my misdemeanours and they can correct it. I refused to go on legal advice, and also the CAA actually agreed with me that if I attended counselling, then I was admitting that I've done something wrong. I refused to because I didn't do anything wrong, and 26 years later I still stick by that. There wasn't a thing that I did wrong that day. So I refused to attend their counselling. They actually rang me up and said, if you don't attend the counselling, we'll suspend your licence. Now, if that's not intimidation, harassment and bullying, I don't know what is, but you know, government departments don't do that. So 9 weeks after the accident, they suspended my licence. That was the worst day probably in my life. I'll be honest, I thought of going outside and topping myself, I really did. I'd saved 25 people's lives, doing the best thing that I'd been trained for, and the government thanks me by suspending my licence and stopping my career. So I did, I couldn't go to the department, I did a couple of times later, but you can't, so I went to the Commonwealth Ombudsman's office. They're independent, they're the government department, totally independent. And I asked them to look into and stop what was going on. So they certainly had a look at it. And this is a letter from Kim Morrison, who is legal counsel. Barry Diamond is the person who suspended my licence, right? So Kim Morrison, legal people in the CAA, write and say, you'll be pleased with attached draft letter, which I have approved to be sent by the Ombudsman to me. Right? So here am I. I'm complaining to the Commonwealth Ombudsman about the department. But the department drafts a letter for the Ombudsman to send back to me about the very department I'm complaining about. And have a look at the arrogance down the bottom. She actually writes, another victory. This shows what I'm up against, you know. This is why on the book we put a true story on the cover. Because would you believe that the Ombudsman and a government department would put things like that? I certainly wouldn't until I experienced it. I've just blown away that they have the hide to do that. It was like I was another notch on the gun or something. I just blew me away. So anyway, the system had suspended my license. Excuse me. It was about August 94. I wrote to the Federal Aviation Administration in the States, told them everything about the accident. Full up, you know, it was probably 3 or 4 pages of email, and said, can I come over and do a check ride in America? So I went to Santa Monica, which if people remember was a DC-1 and Douglas aircraft, and there was this aeroplane, which was John Travolta's old DC-3. So again, John and I are a bit like that, you know, so not a problem. So this old codger came out and he gave me a thorough check ride, and he said to me, and he actually put it on writing to the, I think a letter to the embassy, that the normal check ride is an hour and a half, and he said he gave me 3 hour check ride, because rightfully so, he didn't want to sign me out if I was possibly a little bit dubious or something like that. So he gave me a 3 hour check ride. And at the end of it, he said to me, he said, Rod, the little box on this form here which says I'm only allowed to put pass or fail in there. He said, I'm going to put pass. He said, I'd like to write a hell of a lot more about your ability on DC-3s. But he said, I can only put pass. So he passed me. So I got a, what the hell is it called, Norm? Airline pilot certificate, I think it is, in the States for DC-3s. And again, that was the highest license available in America. So I came back to Australia. And under ICAO convention and all that, if I get a license overseas, they have to recognise it back here. Before this too, I should say that after they suspended my license, they said to me, Rod, we've got a guy in Canberra writing a license, a test specifically for you. And I thought, do you think I came down the last shower? They're suspending my license. That would have been the biggest setup in the world has seen to make sure I never passed it. So I never gave them that satisfaction at all. So that's why I went to the States. They are seen on the service to be sharing and caring organisations, but they're not. So anyway, I get the license, come back here, and Barry Diamond, who suspended my license, right, wrote me a letter saying he's lifted the ATPL and endorsement is lifted, right? Then he goes on to say, the acceptance by the authority of your recently does not in any way signify acceptance or support of any actions undertaken by you in your capacity as pilot in command of the aircraft that crashed. Right? I find that incredible. A government department goes to say that. You know, that just shows how vindictive they are. And to write those sort of things in a letter is just unbelievable. To which I then say, well, what did they want me to do on the day? And I know exactly what they wanted me to do on the day. They wanted me to crash and burn. That way, I wouldn't have created a whole lot of fuss like I did. They would have put it down to pilot error. Yep, all game, set and match. But to write something like that is just unbelievable. Anyway. That's right. That's exactly right. But even, as I said, doing the FAA check ride, they sort of don't even knock that. And that's, don't even accept it. They knock it, and this sort of actually knocks the FAA as well. Anyway. You're right. In 1996, I think this was, in the Weddin Sea, which is near the Netherlands, a DC-3, cruising along 1,000 feet above the ocean, had incredibly similar circumstances to myself. He had an engine failure and the left propeller would not fail to, sorry, it failed to feather. It went in and out of feather, motored in and out, which there was a procedure for it, and I don't know whether the guy did it or not. To cut a long story short, the aeroplane carrying 32 people crashed into the Weddin Sea and killed everybody on board. The other sad thing about it is where they are, the water was 1.2 metres deep. It was over on a sandbar. So I'm not speaking ill of the dead or anything like that, but if they had considered a ditching, it's possible the people could have got out and sat on the wings and put their pinkies in the water. It's very, and again, there's airline people here now. I won't go into it. It's mentioned in my book. I take airlines, airline manufacturers, and authorities to task because ditching is not taught. It's hardly even mentioned by any airline in the world. And I think that is sad. And now that we're going from the big jumbos down to the twin engine aeroplanes again, and air travel over 70% of the earth is over water, I'd like to know that the guy up the front can ditch an aeroplane. And as I said, it's not like a crash landing. It's a highly skilled maneuver and nobody's teaching it. Why not? Costs money. So this happened in 96. At midnight one night about 2.5 years ago, 3 years ago, I was doing nothing. So I Googled DC-3 simulators. And why would you do that? Nobody builds a simulator for a 50, 60, 80 year old aeroplane. Nobody would do it. So I don't know what possessed me, but I did. And MPS, Multi-Pilot Simulations, came up, and this gentleman, second from the left, Dick Verberg, had just built this DC-3 simulator. And I contacted him and told him all about it, the accident, and he immediately contacted me back. He wanted to know why I had very similar circumstances in my DC-3 as this gentleman had. Why the entirely different outcome? So he invited me over, asked me to test fly the DC-3, and Hewitt on the left is the facilities manager, Dick Verberg, Tom Van Huren. He was a Boeing 777 check and training captain for KLM, and he was Dutch Dakota Airline DC-3 check and training captain. So he was in the right seat while I'm flying it. and then the smooth character on the right there. So. It is. I think possibly what happened, and I don't know, the accident report, if you want to see a good accident report, read the report on this, which is available on the net. I would think, remember I said if you get below a certain speed, you lose control and go over on the back. I think that's possibly what happened with that guy. He got below, we call it VMCA, and it's a velocity minimum control in the air. And if he got below that, he might have spiraled in, still flat. It may have gone over, but I don't think so. I think he sort of lost control and it's gone in, sort of pancaked in, I think. But he
relate that to a store? Did he store it or did he?
Well, he may have. See, that's what I'm saying. It's not clear in the report, between 1,000 feet and in the water. It's not clear what the airplane. No flight data recorders or anything in these old airplanes. There's two or three photos of this on the net, and the damage, it's broken the back. See, just near the, there's the door, there's the rear door. It's broken the back about where the wings are, and there's a cockpit up there twisted to one side. So it's a bit uncertain, Brendan, what he did to get in that position. But I'd say he certainly lost control of the aeroplane. Because if you do it in any aeroplane, if you lose control, you've lost control of the aeroplane and what's going to happen to it and everything. That's why, and this is just my view, it has nothing to do with this talk now. You know, there's aeroplanes, Cirrus and all these things, I think they've got a drag chute out the top. You know, if you have an engine quit or something, you know, you pop the lever and a parachute comes up. I don't know whether I totally agree with that. I'd be very dubious to using it because, as I said, once you lose control, you've got no idea where it's going to impact or anything like that. But that's another story. So in the DC-3 simulator, we put in Sydney Airport because Dick wanted to know exactly how it was going to work out. And there's the power levers down here, etc. We programmed the simulator. The Barzi report alleged I was overweight, so we put all that in. We put everything that they could hammer at us into the simulator. So at 200 feet on takeoff, the simulator quit the left engine. And guess what happened? Absolutely unbelievable. It kept flying up, as it should have done. And Tom, in the right-hand seat, I said, this is nothing like my aeroplane. Nothing at all. It just kept flying up. So we did it in the simulator, a left-hand circuit, as I had hoped to do 25 years ago, and landed single engine landing, uneventful. And so we experimented then with how I could replicate my drag chute feel and things like that, you know, how the aeroplane just kept going down. So left engine failed on this. In the simulator, we actually did it, and we brought the right engine back to about 800 horsepower. These engines, Pratt & Whitney 1830s, are supposed to develop 1200 horsepower. So we had to bring the right engine back to about 800 horsepower before the situation was identical to what I had. So what I firmly believe at the time, and still do, and this confirmed it, that right engine was not producing the power. So the interesting thing is nobody would ever believe me. Well, in the report, the Barzi report, you can ask for this, you can download it and things like that. And this is the official report. It says the right engine, page 14. With the exception of the propeller governor, no pre-existing abnormalities were found in the right engine. So as far as Barzi, the official, it's all okay, producing 1200 horsepower. But 3 years later, I get documents out of the Bureau of Air Safety, which say, now I'm saying this specifically so that you people with a knowledge of engines know. So they say they took the spark plugs out of the right-hand engine and they cleaned them, re-gapped them, and then tested them, right? In that order, that's what they did. They didn't test them as they found them. They cleaned them first, then re-gapped them, and then tested them. And you know what they found? The right-hand engine, 11 out of the 28 spark plugs that should have kept us in the air were unserviceable. So that sort of, I'm no mechanic, but that sort of gives me reason to believe why that right engine was down to about 800 horsepower, right? With 11 out of the 28 spark plugs unserviceable. And they don't want to know anything about that. They gave it to me in documents. I went to the Bureau of Air Safety Investigation twice and saw the big honches and said, that report is not good. And they said, yeah. And I said, well, you're going to rewrite it? No. Why not? We don't have to. So this is what I'm up against. So this is why I've written a book, so everybody can see what I'm up against. We'll just go quickly to the summary. Please remember I had 46 seconds, right, from shutting down the engine to being in the water. Sully had 208, not a lot of time, but if you remember, and again, the film is quite accurate, the NTSB, in Sully's case, remember, if you remember, he was put at fault for quite a while because they all said, oh, he could make it back to LaGuardia. And why did he go into the Hudson? Then they said, Sully and Stiles, the first officer, said, well, you haven't given us any time for human factors, like shock. Hello, geez, listen, you know, we're not used to this. There's nothing in the book. Sully and I have nothing in the book about these sort of things. So you've got to work out what you're going to do. In Sully's case, the NTSB gave him 30 seconds of human factors time. Then when they built in the 30 seconds of the simulator, not one person could make LaGuardia. They all had to ditch in the Hudson. So imagine if the system gave me 30 seconds think time. But they didn't. They didn't want to know. It's very unprofessional. Civil Aviation Authority, they unjustly, as in all the reasons I gave for suspending my license, were just so full of holes. There wasn't anything there. And they willfully went out and destroyed my career and took my license off me. And as I said, the harassment I talked about before, it is so wrong. Bureau of Air Safety Investigation, that report, it's fundamentally flawed, it's inaccurate, it omits vital information, and it should be rewritten. That report is an embarrassment to Australia and Australians. If you read the other report into that other Dutch Dakota one, which was a thoroughly professional report. Commonwealth Ombudsman's Office, hey, you know, I got no further words to talk on that. I thought they were a complete arbitrator, independent. So three government bodies failed me dismally. I don't know whether they colluded, or I've got no idea whether they colluded or not, but I think it's very sad. Who or what caused the accident? That's very interesting. In my mind, it's very, very obvious. There's a couple of things I haven't talked about, and I'm conscious of the time. Remember I said about the spark plugs, 11 out of the 28 were unserviceable, right? That aeroplane was 4 hours out of 100 hourly. Now in 100 hourly servicing, they check the spark plugs, right? Also, on the morning of the accident, in the logbooks, the maintenance people said that they had changed the left engine, the one that had failed, they said they had changed the left engine the morning of the accident. And then, in the logbook, they crossed it out and put entered in error. Right? Now, one of the things that I didn't tell you, and going back to now, very important. The co-pilot went along the top of the aeroplane, right? Was Nick Leach, his father Jeff Leach. Together they owned the aeroplane and they're both licensed engineers and they did the maintenance on the aeroplane. So I use the term did the maintenance on the aeroplane. When we ditched the aeroplane, Jeff, the father, dispatched us from up the north there and watched us sort of taxi out and take off. He also watched the aeroplane ditch, crash, right? So his son's on board, his son's a co-pilot. He watched his son crash. You know what Jeff did? He hopped in his car and drove to Camden Airport, where the maintenance was carried out, and the maintenance facility for the aeroplane, where all the logbooks are and things like that. It's just, he watched his son crash. Didn't even go to the hospital. We were in the ward at the hospital. There was the three pilots in the same ward. And Nick, the co-pilot, we were there from about 10 a.m. in the morning till 4 p.m. they released us. And Nick did not utter one word in that 6 hours. Not one word. We were trying to get him to talk. We were trying to get him to... We were quite jovial, and I think it was a shock reaction from being in an accident and we were walking away. Nick did not say one word. His girlfriend came in, tried to get him to talk. Nothing. I would like to think what was going on in his head, but I think I know what was going on in his head. So who or what caused the accident? Painfully obvious, the maintenance or lack of maintenance on that aeroplane. It is so, so obvious. If you read the report and read other things that are in my book about it, it's fait accompli, it really is. But who's responsible? The maintenance caused the accident, but who's responsible? It's the Civil Aviation Authority. Because the Civil Aviation Authority's charter is to make sure we're licensed okay, we do our job. Remember I said how many check rides I'd done and things like that, right? So the Civil Aviation Authority is supposed to oversee, but, and I didn't put this in the book, there's a lot of things I couldn't put in the book. Jeff, the father, and I think his name was Dick Wilkinson, who was airworthiness director at the time, they're old school buddies, right? So you can't beat that. You just can't beat that at all. So who or what caused the accident? Some people say, why did it take me 25 years to write the book? Basically, to uncover the truth behind the sinking of the DC-3 and the sinking of Rod Lovell. Another question which people ask me quite commonly, they said, well, after your license was... After I got my license back, I tried to go back into flying. Most of these people here would know Dick Lang up here, who sadly passed away about 6 weeks ago. I was working for Dick Lang before the accident. After the accident, he asked me to come back and do check and training on the DC-3s. Civil Aviation Authority said, you can't have Rod back. And they told a whole lot of lies about it, about me, as to why Dick couldn't have me back. Now, the interesting thing is, I then later on put on a grievance procedure against the Civil Aviation Authority over this. And the guy that told Dick Lang, he said, I didn't say that at all. I wouldn't say that. But I got copies of his file notes, and he said, I told Dick such and such. So they just lie like you wouldn't believe. And I find that, so I wanted to get the RFDS, fly with the RFDS, and that was another interesting one. Long story, I couldn't have it because of that report. And people say, what did you do to meantime? Well, I drove buses, I drove semi-trailers, I drove taxis, I drove forklifts, I drove anything to get food on the table. So this is the one I was telling you about, Mike. I think that's a very good slide, that one. It might take me, it's 26 years now, but stuff them, I'm still gunning for them in a big way. So that's it. That's it in a nutshell. We've got a few minutes for questions, and we've got about 5 minutes for questions before we've got to be out of here, otherwise I'll never be asked back again. David?
It sounds like some of these people need to be sued, Rod. What's going on there?
Well, I learned years ago, never take a government department, never take a bank to court, because you'll never win, because they just drag it out, adjourn it until you run out of money. When I went to the AAT, which wasn't in the slide, about my pilot's license suspension, in 94, a QC cost me $5,000 a day. I never even got paid for that trip, so how could I? So you can't do that. You just, and this is my way now of letting the whole world know, and a lot of my books are going overseas, letting the whole world know the truth now about it. I wouldn't take the government on now. You can't. You just can't afford it financially. So any more questions? We've got a couple of minutes.
Just a couple of quick ones, Rod. What was the reason of the failure of the left engine?
All right, quickly to it. There. Rocker arm, right? Each side of the rocker arm, there's supposed to be a washer. One was fitted incorrectly, and it actually lodged around the push rod, the top of the push rod, and had been there, I would say, hundreds of hours, because if you look at this photo, you can see the chafe mark there, where it's actually worn into the push rod. And what happened, it had been there so long, it had actually then started to deform, I guess, to fit around the push rod. And on that day, was just on takeoff, obviously I'd done something, I'd kicked the engine or done something wrong, and it dislodged from up the top, went down and held the intake valve open. So what that meant was that every time that cylinder fired, the flame front went all through the intake of that engine. So it felt, you know, it was a straight engine failure because everything that sucked in had already been burnt. So that's what caused it. That gets a mention. These two people are still working on aeroplanes. Not a problem. The maintenance, as I said, is just...
The second part was similar to that. When you did your run-up and make check, was there any indication on either engine of anything going wrong?
No.
Like if you've lost 11 out of 28 plugs, normally you get a make drop.
Exactly, but that's presuming there's two of those plugs per cylinder, right? And there may not have been, I don't know, they didn't tell me what cylinders these have been out of. But also too, with that, as a very valid point, Pratt & Whitney in their own documents say that there is no point doing a run-up with a variable pitch propeller. They say there's no point at all. And I got a photo in my book, but not in here now, of a club prop. You've heard of a club prop? A club prop is a big wooden propeller, fixed pitch, so it's a big hunk of wood. Yes, that's exactly right. Well, like that, but they're normally four blades, right? And they're, so what you, yeah, almost like that over there. And they used to use them, they used to be very common when the airlines had them. But if you did an engine overhaul, you'd put one of these test club props, they call them, on the front. And if that made the RPM, you knew that all cylinders were producing the power. So Pratt & Whitney say there's no point in doing an engine run-up, but there was no missing or anything like that at all. But that doesn't mean that it still was producing the required power. So very valid question. John.
Rod, since you've written your book and been doing these talks, have you heard anything from the CIA?
No. The only thing I've heard, I've done a couple of radio interviews and the producers have then rung up the CAA, or CASA as it's now known, and Peter Gibson is a PR guy and he's obviously employed for being the Mr. Smoothie. He just comes up and says, no comment. That's all he will tell the producers, no comment. So I think the proof's in the pudding there. David?
Somewhere along the line in your career, annoy the Department of Civil Aviation.
If you read my book, David, I've ruffled a few feathers in my career. I really no, but you're quite right. What this came down to.
There's got to be a reason for all this.
There were people like Bob Greenwood was the guy that rang me up. He was in Moorabbin, right? He used to fly the Ventura around, ex Air Force. He was the guy that said, if you don't attend counselling, we'll suspend your licence. It became just after the initial interviews, it became a power struggle. You've got to remember too, and I think this is important, just prior to my accident, a couple of months prior I think it was, a Navajo hit the hills at Young and killed about six or eight people. I think there was a politician on board or something like that. So that was a fatal accident. About 3 months after this, there was a Seaview accident, and when again nine people or something disappeared between Port Macquarie and Lord Howe. So the CAA is reeling under public pressure, why these aeroplanes, and I fell out of the sky too, Why are these aeroplanes falling out of the sky? So I firmly believe it became a power struggle, and plus also I was a sacrificial head on a plate. I really was. They knew I couldn't fight them. Why would I fight them? You know, I didn't have the money or anything like that. But the more I fought them, the more they dug the heels in. The Commonwealth Ombudsman's Office actually said to me, they said, the CAA has got egg on its face over you. And I said, it certainly has, but I didn't put it there. They're quite capable of doing that themselves. And the other thing too is getting back to counselling. So I admit I ruffled feathers a little bit. They wrote me a letter first off, and they said, we deem counselling is necessary. So it's only Rod could do. I said, I totally agree. When are you going to undertake it? Now, that, for some reason, and they wrote back to me and they said, we are not impressed with your smart ass comments. Well, stiff, you don't know Rod then. And it is. You know, there's people here that know me for quite a while. I'm not a shrinking violet, am I? You know? So it's, no, it's been a very interesting road. Norm?
Rod, just a quick one. You said there were three pilots.
Yep.
Up front. Surely with even the guy that was part of the, you know, the family doing the maintenance, the other guy would have been the adjudicator or someone in the middle there somewhere?
What happened was, I was in the left-hand seat, the co-pilot's in the right-hand seat, he's a pilot flying. In the centre seat was a good mate, Andrew Buxton. He had been endorsed on the DC-3 probably a month or two before. He had done no overseas, over water experience, so he came along for the experience. And he got it. He got it. He did very good. He didn't do anything in the emergency at all, so he did very good by, remember, 46 seconds. I don't want people chapping in my ear saying, oh, you thought of doing this, or you thought of doing that. So he did the... Well, so he did the right thing by doing nothing, because he wasn't experienced enough on the DC-3 or over water or ditching or anything. So I commend him on that by just doing nothing. So.
But he would have been on your side when you had to talk to Cassar or all these.
Yeah, guys. But they didn't want to know the truth. Yeah. Then I'll tell you another story of the investigation. I don't know whether you know Norm. Wing Commander John Thine was the Director of Air Force Flying Safety when I went in. He was invited to attend the investigation. The Air Force still had DC-3s at the time. So he was invited to attend and sit in and contribute. But the second day he was asked to stay away because he didn't agree with the road they were taking. And I've spoken to him since. I spoke to him a couple of months ago, and he said, Rod, he said, when I was there, we thought we knew, you know, the way the investigation was going, but then I was asked to stay away and not contribute, so. Better go.
Before we finish, there's got to be a crash air crash investigation and a movie, right?
We were just watching last night Wolverine on, and who's the guys? Hugh Jackman.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm happy for Hugh Jackman to play me because, after all, our bodies are very similar, you know. So.
Well, thanks for coming along. I mean, seriously, that was really fascinating. And best of luck.